This is Inayat. And shortly after she was born, she became the center of my world. And I began to see my role in this world very, very differently. And you know what? I always knew I was having a baby girl. Shortly after I found out that I was pregnant, I put it out into the universe with great conviction that a baby girl was growing inside me. But with that conviction came a lot of fear and a lot of anxiety. And that anxiety usually struck at around 3 a.m. when I had woken up to pee for the 15th time at night. Now, that anxiety came from being a first-time parent, but there was a deeper, more profound anxiety that I just couldn't shake. If, in fact, I was having a baby girl, what was the world that she was inheriting? And what would it mean for her to be a woman in this world? Now, I moved to India in 2011, and shortly after that, I began working with Empower, the Emerging Markets Foundation. So, through my job at Empower, I began traveling across India, and I met with such inspiring young people. But it was the adolescent girls that really inspired me. They were clued in, they had something to say, they had an opinion, they were saying things that truly mattered. And I wondered, how could I, in my role, enable them to be seen and to be heard? We all want to be seen. We all want to be heard. But it's still shocking to me, not only in India, but globally, girls are silenced from the day that they are born. They are told that they're the lesser sex. They are told that they should not have an opinion. And they are told that they should not be visible. This really affected me personally. What I found very interesting is that from the adolescent girls that I met with, I learned that this invisibleness, that them becoming invisible, happens very centrally when they become adolescents. And it's funny, really, because adolescence for boys generally means greater freedoms, being able to go outside, being able to do things that they could not do as children. Conversely, for girls, it means that they have to stay at home, shoulder more responsibility within the home, such as fetching water and cooking food and taking care of younger siblings while both their parents are in the office, or both their parents are out to work. So I thought, what can I, in my role as somebody who is working with local NGO partners, what can I do to hand over the microphone? Well, first of all, it's not enough for girls to be seen and for girls to be heard. They need to be at the center of the conversation. Now, there's many ways in which we're doing this at Empower. The first is through the Adolescent Girls Learning Community in Mumbai, where girls are the decision makers and they are at the center of the conversation. They conceive, design, operationalize real-world solutions to issues within their own community. Now, what's the result of this? Well, the first is that girls petition their local corporators to set up street lighting within their own community so they could walk around safely in the nighttime. The second is girls petition to put up doors on their own public toilets so that they could go to the loo safely. Girls also spoke to their local police officers so that they could, the police could change their patrol route so that they could safely walk to and from school without getting sexually harassed. The girls thought of the issues, the girls thought of the solutions, and then the girls implemented them. Another way in which we've placed girls at the center is by giving girls the power. Through an initiative called the With and For Girls Collective, we enable the girls to be in the driving seat. And they're the ones who make decisions about which NGOs globally receive substantial funding to further their own work with girls. They have the power. They are the final decision makers. So it got me thinking. We've done all this stuff with girls whereby they're at the center of the conversation. But how do we push the envelope a little bit further? The key to that is participation. And from that was born the idea of the Girls Advisory Council. So what exactly is a Girls Advisory Council? Well, it's one girl, One adolescent girl from each of our grantee partners coming together to be our lead advisors and our lead strategists. They're coming with their multiplicity of voices, their lived realities, and they're coming to us to tell us about how we should define our strategy within India. So who are these girls? They're first-generation learners from rural Rajasthan who are making a name for themselves in their, through their education. There are girls from the Basties of Mumbai who are learning English and computers so that they can find a job after they complete secondary school. There are girls from Pune who are learning electrical training, a trade that's off limits to most girls because they are women. There are girls in Ahmedabad who are studying science for the first time. Again, a subject off limits to them because they are women. And here in Delhi, there are girls from Trilokpuri who are leaving their home for the first time since adolescence to work in the retail sector. And there are girls from Ghaziabad who dream of a better future for themselves while simultaneously engaging in their family's profession of waste picking. So how do we do it? Well, we listen. We hand them the microphone. We ask them, what is it that they truly need to be able to complete secondary school? What facilitation do they need to earn a decent livelihood? How can they safeguard and control their own bodies so that their bodies are theirs and theirs alone? How can they stay safe at night? And using these suggestions, we then define our strategy within India. So what are the outcomes of this? There's three outcomes. The first is we amplify their voices. The second is that we increase our chances for success. And the third is that we become accountable to this group of girls. So what do I mean by that? By amplifying their voices, we put the microphone in their hands and we listen. In order to increase our chances of success, we remove all of the externalities. There are many reasons why development projects fail or are less successful. There's a lot of social, cultural, and monetary reasons why development projects cannot effectively get off the ground. By working with these girls from inception, we are seeing those very same problems from their perspective. And we are enabling them to provide us with the insight that we might not have seen as development experts. And finally, we increase our accountability to these group of girls. So not only are they providing us with suggestions, they are enabling us to be able to be accountable to them. As Empower, they are the people that we have become accountable to. So what does this mean for girls, for Empower, for international development, and for the rest of the world? For the girls, the microphone is now firmly placed in their hands. They are seen and they are heard. And in the future, if anybody ever tells them that they're not good enough or that they must be silent, they will fight back because they know how to use their voice. For international development, essentially, we're proposing a paradigm shift. We're not looking at solutions from the top down. We're looking at solutions from the bottom up. We are asking the stakeholders who are most affected by change to be central in defining and driving that change. And for the world, there is a youth voice, and it's getting stronger every day. And this voice is insightful, it is wise, it is powerful, and it has a lot to say. So the question is, how can we, in our day-to-day lives, hand over the microphone to young people? For me, the answer is very, very simple. It begins with this group of adolescent girls. And in the same way that Inayat became the center of my world when she was born, this group of adolescent girls has become central to all that we do in India. And I know that when Inayat becomes a teenager, the world will be a better place for her strong and powerful voice. Now, in the meantime, there's one thing left to do. Let's hand over the microphone. Thank you.